Sometimes we don't have exactly the right word we need to talk about something. I think this may be the case with Lacanian psychoanalysis, because everything in it that constitutes a whole doesn't get to be a whole without adding in something adverse, something alien. For example, a sentence is not completed until the ending of it is retroactively restored to the beginning, in the same way that a story, to be a story, requires its ending to answer to what happened in the opening lines. Lacan's famous concept of extimacy also requires us to include opposites into any measure of the whole, the inside to the outside and outside to the inside. So, everywhere in Lacan we have this idea of a circuit that is not complete unless we add another circuit. So I found this term used by mathematicians and electrical engineers that is about this same kind of equation of surplus and lack, which is the Hamiltonian, and I'd like to use it to address the question of topology. I propose that we think about the Hamiltonian as a global situation that requires itself to be localized, and to coin another term, I'll borrow from the art of M. C. Escher, in particular his famous staircases, to suggest that the Hamiltonian is invisible and unknowable until it immerses itself into local conditions, and that these always involve some kind of contradiction. Let me begin by calling up the familiar model of communication developed by Warren Weaver and Claude Shannon. Of course, psychoanalysis has a lot to say about how there is more to a message than meets the ear, so to speak, or rather how the ear is able to hear an acousmatic voice inside the acoustic one. In the midst of what we think we are saying, we are always saying more. And what the other person thinks you said is always a matter of demand intersecting with desire, the little a, negotiating a deal with the big other. The Hamiltonian is about language's self-intersection of the end with the beginning, and this retroaction makes language fundamentally topological, because it is always non-oriented, that is to say, the noise that is pushed into the background is forever trying to push its way into the foreground, making everyday speech into a Hamiltonian message, from the real of the unconscious. The push-pull relation of noise to signal is topological, in ways that popular culture is able to use with great effect. In boundary conditions such as between the sanitary world and the unspeakable horror of things we flush down the toilet, the fear of backflow is so deeply embedded that it can be used by fiction to produce predictable audience responses. The immediacy of the horror in this scene in Gene Hackman's film, The Conversation, the intellect is defeated by our response, showing how the boundary was constructed in the first place, as insulation between the reality of the symbolic from the real of trauma and the unconscious. Our ability to assess the way boundaries work is entirely dependent on our understanding of topology. Unfortunately, even Lacanians who are intent on taking Lacan's topological interest seriously have made some critical errors in understanding this special branch of mathematics. There is much one can learn about projective geometry, even from such accessible sources as ChatGPT. But Lacan's topology is a bit easier to grasp than most mathematical descriptions. Let's say that much can be understood simply by thinking about the way non-orientation and self-intersection, the properties we can see easily in the Möbius band, can apply to a broad range of things that we find every day in psychoanalysis. We need to focus on these particular properties to think of things like the après coup, retroaction, and the whole issue of logical time. The Hamiltonian opens up the matter of non-orientation and self-intersection in readily available examples, such as the biblical story of the Tower of Babel where the upper part of the building is unfinished, thanks to God's intervention. It is Lacanian, in that God fears something that Lacan mentions as the quality of non-human kind of speech, non-bijective correspondence. Human speech, as we know, came out of God's response to this kind of correspondence, and the top of the tower stands for the way in which human speech itself needs to be completed by a remainder that can't be assimilated, by the symbolic structure below. Yet, completion will always be the issue that makes the psyche what it is in relation to speech. The problem with contemporary Lacanian incursions into topology is that most of them make one of two serious errors. The first is to think that projective geometry is a kind of rubber sheet affair, a science that begins with Euler's treatment of the problem of the bridges of Königsberg in 1725. To be accurate about it, this is the beginning of graph theory, but it doesn't have anything to do with projective topology. Yet, these five popular books push this idea. Some truly foundational books commit a second kind of error. This is the failure to mention, even once, Lacanian works where topology plays a key role, notably Seminar 9, Identification, and 14, The Logic of Fantasy. In addition to this, neither of these books make any mention of the actual founder of projective topology, Girard Dasarg, who got the idea from Pappus of Alexandria, who discovered in 300 AD that projectivity was logically prior to Euclid. These mistakes are incomprehensible, in that Lacan never seems to get it wrong. He never cites the bridges of Königsberg, he mentions Desargues in multiple places, and he even cites projective geometry and the projective plane as the basis of his topological thinking. Lacan is also able to spot topology when it comes under different covers. Here, I add two such sources of my own, Raymond Roussel, who invented the idea of the procédé, and Georges Perec, who invented the clever device of the missing letter, the lipogram. I haven't read any Lacanians to date who have picked up on these clear references to topology. Lacan does, however, use authors who are closet topologists, such as James Joyce, who in both Ulysses and Finnegan's Wake creates literary versions of items that are foundational to projective geometry, such as the Villasow cut, the Borromeo knot, and the Klein-Cayley matrix. Except for the Borromeo knot, no commentators to date have noticed the way the Villasow cut of the torus is able to relate to the two voids, one that is continent, the other that is incontinent, in a way that implicates the Euler circle's definition of union without intersection. I would add a source that was a favorite of Joyce's, but not mentioned either by Lacan or Lacanians. This is the new science of Giambattista Vico. Vico shows that he's interested in topology by inserting a curious graphic into his major work, where he uses both the lipogram of Perec and the prosodé of Roussel to assert what amounts to an 18th century version of Lacan's theory of metaphor, involving simultaneity and sequentiality. Vico's image in the 1725 edition can be seen as a virtual catalogue of Lacanian ideas, with different names of course, tuned to his interest in showing how cultures develop from an original cyclopean condition to modernity. Lacanians don't like to talk about ancient days, but they do talk a lot about childhood, and Lacan himself emphasized the importance of the human child's prolonged development. What we get here that's truly new relates to the theme of the Hamiltonian, in that what lies outside of the system, which is to say divine providence, is reincorporated into it at the level of fiction, what Lacan identified with the Latin saying, ex falso quodlibet sequitur, from the starting point of the lie, anything is possible. What we get with Lacan's topology is a remarkable consistency, beginning with the properties of the torus that allow him to expand it via the diagram that is called the fundamental polygon, a kind of set of folding instructions that Lacan uses to expand the repetition of demand, the tube of the torus, to alienation and suppression, the hole in the donut that is the empty structure of the big other. Along the way, Lacan mixes in the Villasow cut, although not by name but with the proxy of Euler circles and the idea of symmetrical difference. With the Borromeo rings and the Kähler-Klein set theory version, he launches into an ambitious excursion into palindromes, the unary trait, and the idea that the little a and the big other are also matters of self-intersection and non-orientation. Lacan is even gracious enough to include the work of a rival, Edmund Bergler, who defines a foundational neurosis that leads back directly to the discourse of the master-servant, and reconnects to the logical time of the oral, anal, and phallic drives. We cannot leave things to sit entirely within these pure topological relations, because there's so much to talk about in art, film, and literature that shows how non-Lacanians unintentionally have used the exact same ideas independently, such as Modigliani's practice of painting image over image on a single canvas, not to save money but rather to deepen his idea of the connections linking his various models and various ways of looking. It wouldn't be entirely stupid to think of Modigliani's canvas as a fundamental polygon of the torus, in the way that his overpainting was a way of connecting the two voids that hovered about his thoughts while painting. We only need to think that topology is not so much about studying mathematics specifically as it is using non-orientation and self-intersection to think through problems in any media, in any situation. In the Danish film, Babbitt's Feast, General Löwenhelm summarizes the story's Hamiltonian conclusion by quoting from a psalm in the Bible that seems somewhat impossibly to be taken from Lacan's playbook directly, by noting that, in the union without intersection of divine providence, opposites meet without converting each other. His somewhat mystical references sound either Taoist, Buddhist, or Borgesian, but we are reminded that the Bible is a relatively recent text with its own foundations in Essene traditions that, if we take them seriously, are all about non-orientation and self-intersection. And, if we get the point of the Hamiltonian's truly topological capabilities, we can find connections between art and theology where it's absolutely essential to revive Freud's interest in the contronym, the single word combining opposite meanings, with the idea that any such abstract or global condition must be immersed into a physical, material situation. Leonardo's painting of the Annunciation could be considered an essay in Lacanian Freudian hysteria, given that Mary has relocated her womb to her ear, and opened the book on the lectern precisely at the moment when she is being impregnated by God, via the angel Gabriel. Why does projective topology seem so difficult? Let me try to condense some of the ways two-dimensional space, which we cannot visualize directly because it has no room for an observer-observed relation, is a kind of inside-out space, where the horizon shrinks to a hollow point through which all of the vectors formerly inside the horizon are now passing through it in various directions. Once this happens, the vectors can be described mathematically by their intersection with a hypothetical plane constructed in a Cartesian, XYZ space. If the plane is set precisely one unit about the x-axis, the point of intersection needs only two coordinates to describe it, and a complex situation has been reduced to a relatively simple one. A topological space has become a space of set relations. The plane that is constructed to calibrate vectors in this way is called the projective plane, but in another sense it is the 2D plane in which forms such as the Möbius band, Klein bottle, torus, crosscap, and so on exist. We cannot see them because there is no third dimension for viewing anything, and although we say these forms can have cuts, the cut is not like a 3D cut into a solid, but rather the cut that we see only when the 2D form is immersed into 3 space. If this topsy-turvy transformation, with its vectors and coordinates, seems ridiculous, consider that the projective plane is not something unique to conceptualization but, rather, is the actual way the imagination operates, and that we can find it in ethnographic examples in almost literal forms. To plumb the logic of this geometry, we have to go back to its origins, so let me take you to a place where no Lacanians have gone before, the proof of Pappus's theorem. You have to watch closely, however, because this is not about any specific point on a line or any specific angle the lines might take, but about the anywhere aspect. You can put these lines at any angle and place 3 points on them at any location. You will get the same results no matter how the points or lines are arranged, so in effect the theorem is about the projective plane as being an anywhere space. What would happen if we take the projective line that is the conclusion of Pappus's theorem and put it into 3 space? It would be the place where lines converged, but they would come from shapes rather than other lines. This is more or less the theorem of Girard Desarges, who showed that, for any observer in 3 space, an opaque object would cast a perfect shadow inside of which other shapes would form, and their sides would all meet on a single line. This is the first mathematical attempt to model the relationship between pure visibility and its twin, pure invisibility. As we move, the two realms change position but never proportion. What we see produces and is affected by what we don't see. Here we can make an important connection to the terms Lacan uses in his discourse Mathemes. If we allow that a shape can be a signifier, an S2, then it casts a perfect shadow in the form of any other signifier, S1, and the idea of the master signifier as an empty structure is fulfilled by Desarges' shadow prism. The relation of the visible triangle that creates this shadow to this anywhere condition is lawful, which is to say that the edges of the two shapes will converge along a single line. Because this will change whenever the subject changes its viewing point, the two are simply different aspects of the same regulatory schema. Desarges' prism of visibility and invisibility anticipates the master's discourse by showing that the subject, who is entirely free to move, is, by that very freedom, continually imprisoned by this rule-bound relation of visibility to invisibility. The master signifier S1 will perfectly trap every visible thing because it is, in essence, the effect of that which we don't know on what we do know, the anticipation of uncertainty and the inescapability of doubt. This is what makes the master seek recognition, even though he is always doomed to fail. Projective geometry's shortest definition is that it shows how anywhere is different from the everywhere of philosophy and the somewhere of ethnology. In effect, it is a bridge between the two, but a bridge that transforms what lies on either shore. The self-generating power of projective topology is never clearer than when it creates a problem, then solves it, but in the process transforms the very meaning of what problems and solutions are for each other. In other words, there is a surplus value that comes out of the self-constructed situation of lack. When Freud forgot the name of the artist of the murals in the Orvieto Cathedral, it was not just that he had forgotten a name related to the name of the father. Lacan pointed out that he noticed something that only a stranger in a strange land would notice, namely the signor in signorelli, something that no Italian native would hear. the suppression of the forgotten name was a downward motion of replacement, causing an immediate opposite effect of expression. The series of metonymies, each of which revealed part of the secret name as Freud's trains and boats crossed the Adriatic. What Lacan saw was the formula for metaphor, a hydraulic relation between the downward plunge and the upward thrust, where metaphor and metonym became Euler circles that created a condition of symmetrical difference, a union without intersection. This, of course, is the Villisot cut of the torus, which explains how Lacan summarizes metaphor as a one of one, signifying a small s double prime, what Dan Collins has said calls a stop to the endless search for more signifieds. Metaphor's hydraulic system is toroidal because it relates the two voids, the contained void of a single travel excursion, and the uncontained void of the forgotten name and its relation to the father, something that could repeat itself in an endless series of self-intersections. Mapping metaphor to the travel landscape explains how the torus, in the form of the fundamental polygon, diagrams how the demand of speech, embodied by repetition, reaches a point of maximum expansion of difference in the contrast between acting out, which Lacan says occurs within the symbolic, with the passage à l'acte, which in the case of parapraxis is Freud as a stranger in a strange land. Elegantly, the system then contracts around the point of alienation, at the point where metaphor and metonym make their diagonal cut across the torus to produce the second void of pure structure, the big other, structure and nothing else. Nothing says Hamiltonian like the torus, which in the form of its fundamental polygon connects the repetition of demand, the tube of the torus, to the void of the Villisot circles. If the Hamiltonian is the global principle, the landscape Freud crossed in his forgetfulness could be called Escher formations, since each metonymy created a figure-ground situation that was fundamentally contronymic. A figure appears out of a ground that was basically a place where there was something missing, and here we have an immediate proof of what Desargues' theorem was all about. No matter where Freud went, with his feeling of complete freedom, he was followed by the perfect shadow, the missing signifier of senior, the thing in signorelli that no one else had seen. Now we know what a perfect shadow is. It's the shadow that's just for us and no one else. Almost everyone tends to think that Lacan's topology thinking is too far out there, too esoteric, too much to tackle. I have the opposite view. I find that Lacan's topology is what grounds him. What brings him down from the clouds to the level of laughter and forgetting, both in the natural exercise of these human traits, but also in the artistic formulations devised to induce laughter without having anyone know the trick of how it's done. Saying that Villisot circles create a bond between a continent void and an incontinent void is really too much to bear. Not even mathematicians can talk this way for very long without collapsing. But if we watch Charlie Chaplin's carefully designed chase scene that ends on a spinning platform, we see immediately how the effect of the perfect shadow can fold space in on itself, so that the tramp actually gets closer to his bete noire in order to get further away. Timing is everything. And even Chaplin has to check his watch, but it's worth it for us to consider that topology is nothing more than how things work, and how we enjoy it. Both when they work, and especially when they fall apart.